Sairam students, welcome to another literature class. And in today's class, we will begin with a poem. And the name of the poem is Amanda. Students, last what we have done in your literature was two stories of flying, after which we have a poem, How to Tell Wild Animals, which is not a part of your portion anymore. Then we also have a poem, The Ball Poem, which is a part of your examination, which we will be dealing next week. But today we'll begin with a new poem, that is Poem 6, Amanda, and this is from your textbook, First Flight. Quickly just keep your books and pen ready to jot down the important points. Now, this poem is written by Robin McMaughlin, who happens to be an Australian author, and she is known to write, she's known for writing books for small children. She was born on February 28, 1936 in Kempsey, South Wales, Australia, and currently she resides in Melbourne. Now, what is this poem Amanda all about? Let us see. In this particular poem, the poet has expressed the views of a little girl, Amanda. She's very small. I think she's close to, say, 10, 12 years. Okay, and this girl is constantly pointed out by her mother for making mistakes. Mistakes which she considers, she is the mother. She feels that these mistakes should not be done by a child. Okay, because they are not a part of good conduct. Okay, the society that we live in, okay, lays down some rules and regulation. There is a way in which we have to conduct ourselves. Okay, maybe Amanda is not following that, and the mother is constantly pointing out, you know, at her mistakes. So this poem is all about that. It's about a small child whose parents are forever nagging her about what to do and what not to do. I think students, even you can relate to it. The age that you are in, parents tend to tell you what to do and what not to do. Not because they want to dominate, but because they want you to live a good life. Okay, there's a code of conduct that we need to follow, you know, when we live in a society. They don't want us to go on a wrong track, right? That's the reason they keep on telling us what is good and what is bad for us. Now, this frequent interference makes her unhappy. This frequent interference by the parents. Amanda, do this. Amanda, do not do that. Don't do that. Okay? So, this makes her very unhappy. It seems as if she is not free to do anything that she wants to do. Now, she's constantly being, you know, nagged by her parents. So, she is not liking this. She wants freedom from all restrictions. She wants to live a comfortable life. She wants to live a life, you know, where there are no restrictions, where there is nobody to point out, you know, whatever she does, she lives life the way she wants to. So let's get started, students, with our poem, Amanda. Don't bite your nails, Amanda. Don't hunch your shoulders, Amanda. Stop that slouching and sit up straight, Amanda. Now, if you see, these are not, these things that the mom is asking Amanda, you know, not to do, they are nothing big, very common things. And what are they? Don't bite your nails. Yes, parents will definitely, you know, tell us not to bite, because it's not a good thing. Biting nails is unhygienic. So maybe even Amanda has got this habit of biting her nails. So her mom is telling her, don't bite your nails, don't hunch your shoulders, Amanda. Maybe her posture is not correct, the way she is sitting. That may lead to problems in near future. So the parent is telling her, don't hunch your shoulder, stop that slouching and sit up straight. What is slouching? Slouching is to sit in a very lazy way. So mother is saying, stop slouching, Amanda, sit up straight, sit properly. Okay, the poet is describing Amanda, a little girl who is always pointed out by her mother for her mistakes and how she imagines her life to be. The poet says that the mother is pointing out Amanda for biting nails, which is a bad habit. Yes, I just told you, Amanda was biting her nails and the mother pointed out, Amanda, stop doing that. That's not a good habit. When you go out, you know, when you're with 10 people and if you start biting your nails, do you think it'll look good? Definitely not. So yes, the mother is trying to, you know, tell Amanda when she is alone with her, that child, don't do this. It's not a good habit. Okay. Next, she asks her to sit straight without bending her shoulders. Okay, hunching is when you sit like this, when you know, when your body is forward like this. It's called as hunching, which is definitely not a good posture, which may create problem in near future. So she is asking her to sit straight without bending her shoulders. Now Amanda has a habit of bending her shoulders and sitting lazily. That's the reason the mother is pointing out at her, because she wants her to sit in the right posture. Clear, students? Now look at this poem here. There is a languid emerald sea where the sole inhabitant is me, a mermaid drifting blissfully. Now the first three lines, if you see, it's the mother who is telling Amanda to do, you know, to not to bite her nails, not to hunch her, not to hunch her shoulders, and to stop slouching as well. Now when the mother is saying all these things, Amanda is into her own imaginary world. Where has she gone? She feels that there is a languid. What is languid? It's a relaxed. Emerald is the green color. And she feels that she is the sole inhabitant over there. She is the only person in that particular sea. And like a mermaid. What is a mermaid? It's an imaginary figure. Okay. Her upper part is like a woman and the lower portion is like a fish. I have a picture of the mermaid for you. So she feels, when her mother is constantly nagging at her, she is into her own world, whereas, you know, she feels that she is somewhere in an emerald sea, okay, where she is all alone, all by herself, like a mermaid, and she is drifting, she is moving blissfully. She is not even bothered what her mother is trying to tell her. Because continuously her mother is, you know, mother keeps on pointing out many things to her. And she is frustrated. She is, you know, she is least bothered. At times, students, I think even you might be doing that. When your parents are constantly telling you something or the other, you must be into some other world. Least bothered what your parents are telling you. Same is the case with Amanda as well. She is not bothered what her mother is telling her. She is in her own imaginary world. At this point of time means the point of time when her mother is scolding her, she imagines herself to be in a deep green sea. She says that she wants to be the only resident of that particular green sea. She imagines herself like a mermaid who is alone there leads her life in a very relaxing way. She says that she wants to be carried away by the current of the water and experience the relaxing environment over there. So yes, she's not bothered what her mom is telling her, what she is into. She has gone into her world of imagination where she is in the deep green sea. I hope, students, the first two stanzas are clear to all of you. Next. Did you finish your homework, Amanda? Did you tidy your room, Amanda? I thought I told you to clean your shoes, Amanda. So I think you can relate to yourself as well. Okay, your parents keep asking you, are you done with your work? Your teacher had given you some school work. Are you done? Saturdays, Sundays. Okay, your mothers must be telling you, clean your room, clean your shoes. Yes? So yes, similar is the case with Amanda as well. Her mom is asking her now, Amanda, are you done with your homework? Have you cleaned the room? I thought I told you to clean your shoes. Maybe she is just lazing around. She is not even bothered, you know, to what her mother has said. Again, she goes back into her world of imagination. But before that, here the poet says that Amanda's mother is inquiring her about whether she has done her homework or not. And then she asked her to clean the room and clean the shoes as well. Now she goes into her own world of imagination. I am an orphan roaming the street. I patten soft dust with my hushed bare feet. The silence is golden. The freedom is sweet. Now what is she telling over here? She says that I am an orphan. Now the imaginary world that she has gone into, she says that, you know, I am an orphan. Who is an orphan? A child who does not have parents. Parents have left the child, or the parents have passed away. That child is called as an orphan. So she feels that I am an orphan now. Maybe the age that she is in, she doesn't realize, you know, this word orphan, because at that point of time, she feels, you know, she's very angry. She doesn't like her mom, you know, telling her constantly to, you know, what to do and what not to do. She's not liking that. So she feels that, you know, she is like an orphan roaming the street. She's just moving here and there. I patten soft dust with my hushed bare feet. Okay, she's drawing patterns. She's making patterns with her hushed. Hushed is silent. Okay, bare feet. Bare means uncovered. Uncovered feet, she is drawing patterns, you know, on the soft dust. The silence is golden, the freedom is sweet. Now, why does she say the silence is golden? Because continuously over here, her mother is asking her to do this and do that. So she feels that how I wish I was an orphan. Nobody around. It will be quiet. Okay, the silence. Nobody is telling me to do anything. So the silence at that point of time would be golden. And freedom is going to be sweet. No restrictions. Nobody to tell me what to do and what not to do. So here we can see that the mother is constantly asking her questions regarding homework being done or not, or whether she had cleaned her room and her shoes as well. But on the other hand, while Amanda is listening to her mother's instructions, she is imagining. Basically, what is she doing? She is least bothered. Though she is physically present in front of her mother, but she is least bothered to what her mother is saying. Now, she imagines herself to be an orphan who is on the street roaming here and there. This means that she imagines if she would have been without parents, she would have walked freely on the streets. And she would have drawn designs on the soft dust with her uncovered feet. So we can see that she thinks opposite to her mother. Mother wants her to do this and she is least bothered. She is not even paying attention to what her mother is saying. Her mother wants her to keep everything neat and clean. But what does Amanda want to do? She wants to play in dust with her bare feet. Moreover, she is so fed up of these constant instructions from her mother. Now she is fed up to the limit that, you know, she says that silence is golden, which means at that point of time, silence is very crucial and very precious for her. And then she feels that, you know, freedom is also sweet because she never feels free when her mother is around. So I hope, students, the four stanzas are very clear to all of you. Don't eat that chocolate, Amanda. Remember your acne, Amanda. Will you please look at me when I'm speaking to you, Amanda? So again, Amanda has done something wrong. What is she doing? She's eating a chocolate. Okay, so what does mother tell her? Amanda, stop eating that chocolate. You remember you get acne, you get pimples. So this is going to create even more pimples for you on your face. So stop eating that chocolate. And please, when I'm talking to you, look at me, look into my eyes. Okay, don't keep looking here and there. Look at me when I am talking to you. Next, Amanda's mother is disallowing her to eat chocolates. She reminds her of pimples that Amanda faces due to eating chocolates. At last, she scolds her for not paying attention to what her mother is saying. Now, let us see, where does she go when her mother is speaking about all these things? She imagines, and what does she imagine? I am a Rapunzel. I have not a care. Life in a tower is tranquil and rare. I'll certainly never let down my bright hair. Now, this story of Rapunzel, I think all of you are well aware of. This girl, you know, she was kidnapped by a witch and she was kept in a tower wherein, she used to just leave her hair down of the tower and the witch would come up with the help of her hair. So she says that I am Rapunzel. Now she thinks that she is a Rapunzel. She's gone to that imaginary world. I have not care. I will not worry about the world around me. Even I would love to go and, you know, stay in a place, isolated place where nobody would come and disturb me. So life would be very calm, tranquil is calm and rare. I'll certainly never let down my bright hair. Look at the hair over here. Look at this picture, students. Look at Rapunzel's hair. Okay, so she says that Rapunzel used to leave her hair down for the witch to come up, but I will not do that mistake. I will not leave my hair down for anybody to come up. Why? Because I want to live my life all by myself. Okay, I don't want any disturbance. Let's see the explanation. So here she says, at this moment, Amanda imagines herself to be Rapunzel. Rapunzel was a character from a fairy tale that was captured in a tower by a witch. The witch used to climb the tower with the help of long hair of Rapunzel that were let down by her through the window. So now Amanda wants to be Rapunzel because she feels that life in the tower will be peaceful and unusual. It will be calm. There will be no disturbance. She thinks she will be free and live in a peaceful environment in the tower. She also confirms to herself that she will never let her head down to anyone so that nobody could come to her in the tower. Look at her frustration level. I mean, she's so frustrated that now she wants to stay all by herself. She wants to stay alone because she's not liking the way her parents are continuously, you know, nagging. They keep on telling her, don't do this, don't do that. So she is tired. She is frustrated. And this happens, students. At this age, children tend to rebel. They don't like parents telling, you know, them anything. But parents on their part are correct. Okay, because they don't want, you know, they want, actually they want the children to live a good life. They want the child to live a comfortable life. Okay, that's the reason the parents want us to finish off our homework. The parents want us to be independent so that we can clean our room all by ourselves. You know, we can clean our shoes. We are big enough so that we can, you know, take up our responsibility at least. Okay, so that is a way that the parents are, you know, trying to teach us many things that will help us in our near future. So that is what even the mother was doing. But what was Amanda thinking? She felt that her parents, you know, they were continuously troubling her. They were pestering her. Let's proceed further. Stop that sulking at once, Amanda. You're always so moody, Amanda. Anyone would think that I nagged at you, Amanda. Okay, so Amanda's mother now warns her for behaving in a very odd manner. She asks her to stop being in bad mood. Sulking is being in bad mood. So she tells her, Amanda, stop sulking. Moreover, she blames her of having such an unstable mood. What does she tell her? You're always so moody, Amanda. So she is telling her that, you know, you're having very unstable mood. She also scolds her by saying that her behavior will one day make people think that Amanda was constantly being harassed by her mother. So she feels that, you know, what other people will tell, that Amanda is constantly troubled by her mother. Okay, which is not the case. I am just trying to tell you how to behave yourself. This is not the way you behave. So please, come on, stop sulking and don't have this fluctuations in your mood. Please, people may take it in a wrong way. So here we can say that though Amanda is always pointed out by her mother on every small thing, but she can't react to it. Correct. Yes. Amanda, when she was being scolded by her mother, did she back answer? No, she did not. But she went into her own life of imagination, wherein she thought she was a Rapunzel, she was a mermaid, she was an orphan. Okay. Because she knows that if she back answers, if she reacts towards this by getting emotional, her mother takes, you know, her mother will take this against her sense of pride. Okay, the mother may not like it. Clear, she is well aware of all these things. So she says that, you know, I am not reacting. As every other child, even Amanda didn't react to this particular thing. If she reacts towards this by getting emotional, her mother takes this against her sense of pride and scolds her that she should not behave like this, as others would think that Amanda's mother is very dominating towards her child. Okay, so I hope, students, the poem is clear to all of you. Now we will meet in the next class and we will begin with the literary devices of this poem. There is one thing that you have to do as students. You have to revise the poem. Okay. And there are some set of questions that are coming your way through a link. Answer them and don't forget to submit them. Till then, students, you will take care of yourselves. Sai Ram and bye-bye.